foundation of human security concept. Unfortunately, Professor Basich won't be able to join us today, so fortunately for our speakers, we have some 2.5 minutes more time. So we're going to start with Professor Miroslav Pendolovski from University of Psychology, Skopje, MIT, from Macedonia.
Okay, it's okay now. Thanks for the opportunity to show some other aspects of human security, for example, psychological. Because without a phenomenological point of view, without a person and entity and personality, it seems like a human security hangs upon the air and not depends on our body, on our senses, and on our consciousness. So I would read and then make some connections with the presentation. We live in an era of comprehensive globalization where by means of conditional reflex, we get unconditional reactions of self-protection. In such a constellation of socio-psychological conditions, it is necessary to set the concept of realism to the feeling of intimate safety. It is necessary to re-examine the deliberation and logic of the claim for personal self-feeling of safety. The struggle for the personal psychosocial identity, self-consciousness, and recognizability makes the man doubt one's own capacity to recognize one's own safety and or jeopardy. A man is faced with the challenge of the need for maintaining his personal borders in a psychological, sociological, and cultural sense through the struggle for self-affirmation. The words of the French reporter Jacques Maldupont that the revolution divorced its own children applied to the phenomenon of globalization questions us, who are those children devoured by it? They are all the faceless entities that have once been separate and unique identities, and today they have become just an undiscernible crowd of many a frightened homunculi, identical in all, even in the feeling of personal jeopardy. Globalization is not here to enable recognizability of the unique, but to assimilate it into a swarm adequate for equivalent conclusions on many bases. It is counterpart of everything that have been united under a holistic veil of the specific, the whole. If personal safety is legal and uninterrupted enjoyment on the part of a human being in his life, his body, his health and reputation, then globalization is a legal means to distance the human being from possessing his own things. Globalization through the legitimate use of the opportunities to connect everyone with one another, to unify the habits, the models of behavior, the ideas and values, with one cracking stroke causes alienation of the man from his own nature, of individual being able to make decisions for oneself. Hence, although seemingly non-existent, a latent phenomenon, it is destructive powers in the form of use of the mass media in the process of de-identification, derealization, and depersonalization of the individual. Thus, this gradual process in which it offers a multitude of distractions are assimilated the natural self-protective borders of every individual who is in process of becoming a person. Meanwhile, natural consequences are the process of new determination of the term personal safety and a relativization of the right of every individual to his own peculiarity and identity. From a completely personally accepted intimate space hatched by the needs and values of a free man, in which he himself feels safe at a psychological and realistic level, his self turns into a diffuse, unclear space of seemingly equivalent socio-psychological alien in-between spaces which are a natural threat to him. This perverse process of long devaluation of the contemporary man questions his understanding of reality in relation to how and whether he feels safe. The concept of personal safety contains more protection from personal harm than protection from invasion on privacy. This exact concept introduces to us the hypothesis that this term in its essence is a psychological entity. Psychologically, the act of destroying someone else's intimacy is a violation of personal safety. But in an era of postmodern majority, especially with the help of globalization, man weapon, mass media, the concept of intimacy and personal space has been relativized, and the same goes for someone's feeling of safety. Personal safety can be seen as a complex phenomenon Okay. Thank you. It's a complex phenomenon composed of two aspects, as a feeling and as a reality. So, seen from the aspect of its being a reality, personal safety presents a mathematical statistical concept based on the relation between the possibility of appearance of all sorts of risks and the effectiveness of their countermeasures. Seen from the aspect of personal safety being a feeling, we treat in the psychological relativity of experience, in the phenomenological idiosyncratic field of the individual differences. Relation inside the two aspects and the relation between them is very,
Thank you.
It's very complicated, multidimensional, and has different directions and interdependencies. Real safety influences the way we feel, whether we feel safe or not. The research shows that in most of the cases, when statistics shows a smaller actual or possible risk of jeopardy, the feeling of personal safety is greater. Still, there are certain aberrations from his finding, from these findings, especially when taking into consideration that some people feel safe even in unsafe conditions. For example, war, violence, crime, etc. And others feel unsafe even in normal, peaceful conditions, in the cases of anxiety, panic disorders, paranoid disorders, etc. Then again, the personal experience of safety or self-convincing that we are safe has a positive influence over the general atmosphere of safety, although it is more so at a level of suggestion and speculation. An excellent example is Benigni's movie La Vita è Bella. Namely, on the one hand, the degree of real risk influences the type, quality, and intensity of measures taken, and on the other hand, as a return, the measures will influence the degree of risk. In case they were efficient, the probability for the same dangers to appear again is diminished. The emotional reaction of fear in case of endangered personal safety creates negative thoughts. Something will happen to me now. They will find us out, etc. As well as negative behaviors, escaping, hiding, shaking, shattering, crying, etc. Their reactions even to the countermeasures we agree with them or not, cognitive, we find them pleasant or not, emotional, they make us react or not, behavioral. If we dwell now on the psychological aspects of personal safety, we can deduce a conception according to which personal safety as a term can be taken as if it is composed of several elements. Some of them are the estimation of danger of victimization, fear of crime, the need for safety, and psychology of risk. Please, once again. All the aspects individually work on the development of an individual concept of experience in the personal safety. Also, all the separate aspects are interconnected and act on each other, thus diminishing or enhancing the unique force of each of them or through direct action on the increase of the cumulative common force. For example, if we think that we are a very easy potential victim of crime, then we perceive risk wrongly, perversely, and thus we increase it. Also, the need for safety depends on whether we experience ourselves as an easy victim or not. Of course, those who believe to be and feel like easy potential victims will have more and more intense needs for safety. Then again, if there is a wrong estimation of potential risk, then the level of fear from crime will be bigger, and this will cause more needs for safety. On the other hand, the high level of satisfied needs for safety will decrease the level of fear from crime, although in reality this does not have to correspond to the personal experience. The perspective of the phenomenon of victimization is based upon the principle that the fear of crime and thus potential victimization is a result of the level, the degree of criminal activity in the society or what people hear about crime, whether from other people or from mass media. This finding itself correctly determines the limit between the real possibility of our becoming a victim and the fear of crime, which makes us potential victims only through the feeling of fear and negative behavior generated through the identification with the public opinion on how much is the danger of victimization present in the moment. In an era of globalization, the mass media disseminates various perceptions, data, views on the real crime rate, and the potential of victimization, which are through synergy on the already formed opinion of the individual. The accuracy of perception is influenced by a series of other psychological and psychopathological characteristics of the individual. There is more emphasized feeling of potential victimization, especially in those cases where distinguished traits of the personality exist as relatively permanent predispositions. The inherent wariness, paranoid character, exceeding caution, analyticity, etc. Of course, add to it the constant bombs of dramatic information backed up with video material. The feeling of becoming a victim is only multiplied and extended. Anxiety, fear of crime, contains within itself a more public estimate of the real problem with crime, whereas the cognitive aspect of the fear of crime stands closest to the concept of potential victimization. Please. Potential victimization and the risk are a result of the way the public understands and the individual's experiences the opportunity of control over the situation. Fear of crime is composed over the three components, emotional, cognitive, please once more, emotional, cognitive, and behavioral. So this is an example of two kinds of processes. In the first situation, when we are experiencing a situation as experienced as dangerous, and potential, then we can become potential victim, then emotional process is going first. For example, feelings of fear, worry, anxiety, panic, etc. That influences the cognitive aspects of personality. For example, thoughts as I am in danger, I have no control over, I will suffer. And then the cognitive aspects makes effects on the behavioral aspects. So hiding, escaping, physiological reactions, and other behavioral processes. So can we see the next slide? This is the inverse, in opposite process, when the cognitive starts first. For example, when we are a potential victim, we can talk about ourselves. I'm in danger, I have no control. Then this causes feelings of anxiety, worriness, panic, etc. And this, at the end, causes such a kind of behaviors as shown on the slide. The ecologic macro prevalence denotes the true real presence of crime, where the personal micro prevalence refers to the personal perception of the dangers of dangers of victimization. These two elements act not only upon the behavioral instance, but the behaviors for adaptation of the individual, also upon the cognitive component embodied in the perceived risks. Both the behavioral component and the cognitive component directly influence the fear of crime, the emotional component, apart from the environmental dangers, if they are real or not. Shire emphasizes that can we see next slide? Thank you very much. This is this interplay, interconnections between these ecological and microecological aspects and interplay between these factors, which at the end shows a big effect on the fear of crime as phenomenological expression and process. Shire emphasizes that when perception of personal safety is not congruent to the real safety, this is so because of the fact that the perception of risks does not correspond to the reality of risk. Apart from the adequacy of the degree of fear of crime and the perception of victimization, the adequacy of perception of real risks has a fundamental importance to the authenticity of experiencing the personal safety. So can we go to the next slide? These examples shows how people react on the perceiving of perception of a risk. So we can see some subjective and individually influenced phenomenological processes and thoughts about becoming a victim of a crime. People have the tendency for dramatization and spectacularity, and they neglect the everyday dangers. Most of the people would be afraid of, say, a big earthquake, a meteorite fall, and so on, events that occur only once in several decades or hundreds of decades. But the reasons, but they would underestimate the everyday risks of car crashes, crime, etc., when thousands of people die every day because of this real and everyday actions of risks. The reason is in the fact that most of the risks are unpredictable and uncertain. Subjectivity disables people to estimate the risks that they haven't experienced. People expect their already known risks and they are not aware of unexperienced risks. The tendency towards increase of the personified risks comes from the ego structures, which by means of identification as a process, can make themselves equal to the victims. For example, when people perceive some victim of a crime, of a risk, as a similar as a personality to us, then people are in a big fear of crime. Then in example, when the victim of crime is not similar to us. Psychology of personality reveals that people are more prone to be scared in events of risks that affect other people in case they see themselves in the personality of the victim. The risks that the individuals take over themselves direct the individuals towards maintenance of the rightness of their decisions, even in situations when the environment clearly realizes the great dangers. People are intended to stay about oneself rightness. If they take, if they choose some risk, they are they have tendency to show us that the risk is real, even if the risk is not real in reality. So it is known that personal dignity and pride have put people in jeopardy, even in life danger. We are probably thinking about personality traits such as stubbornness, adventurism, obstinacy, etc. Added to the conclusions of the previous paragraphs, is Shire's claim that people tend to overestimate the risks that are publicly spoken of and they are mysterious and unsolved. Such an example might be the many mysterious risks of unsolved murders, disappearings, and so on. So we can fear about the Jack the Ripper and not fear about the everyday dangers because of the public tendency to show these kinds of risk as very mysterious, unpredicted, and so on. So I think that these psychological aspects are neglected in the literature and in the researchers about human security as a whole, especially in the personal security as a one dimension of the human security. And I expect to have in future more researchers, theoreticians, and practitioners as I am, because I am working with people in practice, and so this kind of paper erases from such practical and clinical experiences and from the, some theories that are talking about the personal safety by a phenomenological personality point of view. So thank you for your attention.